All right, thank you very much for the introduction, for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. I'm going to talk about some results that we have recently kind of obtained with Zoe and with Mitch, and that have to do with, in particular, relaxation. So I will have a little bit of electronic structure and just a little bit, but not very much. And most of this will be about the geometry and the relaxation that happens in bi-layers, so that we kind of understand this part, and tri-layers, that I think is more new and definitely more difficult and more interesting. So just to recall, we are looking at structures in general that looks like this, and as has been mentioned already several times, in general there is no periodic order, so at best you can hope for a large supercell that gives you some measure of periodicity, but a much larger scale, and therefore much more computationally intensive. And in the worst case, actually, you cannot hope for any periodicity, and then you have to change a little bit gears, because the usual methods will not work. And in particular, what we can see is two kinds of Moiré patterns. So I have also this little movies that show you. So you have Moiré patterns that appear like this due to a mismatch between the lattice constants. So here there is no twist angle. I just have two hexagonal lattices that are superposed, and they have a different lattice constant, and therefore I get kind of a pattern that appears when the ratio is not too close to one, and the length scale would be something that looks like this. Or I could also have a twist angle, and the same way, the twist angle creates a Moiré pattern that depends this time on the size of the twist angle. The smaller it is, the bigger the Moiré length scale. So we have these new, you know, length scales that appear into the system. They are not periodic length scales, but they're definitely important length scales that give you all kinds of interesting effects. And so the images that come out of dark field, for example, will show this kind of Moiré patterns. So in this case, there is a little bit of experimental techniques that go into getting these pictures. So these are beautiful bilayers of graphene at a pretty large scale here. We see the Moiré pattern appearing very neatly in shades of black and gray. at a pretty large scale, and here this is a twist angle around 0.4 degree. And one thing which is striking to me, at least when I look at this, this doesn't look at all like the Moiré pattern that I was looking at on the previous picture, in that it's a really sharp picture where the transition happens really fast between them with a kind of domain walls. So it's not the smooth transitions that you would see in a Moiré pattern that you expect if you look at the previous picture. It's much sharper, so there is something at play here. It turns out that this is important for the electronic structure later, but it's also interesting in its own right that the lattice essentially distorts a little bit in order to be more energetically favorable. All right, so this is kind of a schematic enhanced picture of what's happening. So here would be an unrelaxed Moiré pattern at a 3-degree twist angle. And here is what happens after relaxation, and what we see is that the lattice essentially prefer to be in this kind of stagnant AB or BA configurations that are equivalent, and does not like to be in the aligned AA kind of configurations. This is enhanced by a factor 10, I think, compared to what actually happens, but it gives you a sense of what's happening. If I plotted this at the Rion scale, we wouldn't actually be able to see anything. So, for bilayers, essentially, this is the story. So then to find the details and compute these pictures, there are some equations and so on that we derived, and that worked pretty well to have a simplified model. But I don't want to talk too much about this for bilayers. I will explain it for trilayers in a minute. But basically, the idea is that we have the sharp pattern. The simplifications, I do not consider too much the out-of-plane modulation. I'm sorry. Yes, this is like graphene. So I have a blue on a red layer, but they are both hexagonal. Right, so we consider only the in-plane shear or strain, and there is no consideration of the energetic, at least, part of the curvature out of plane. All right, so this is my little contribution to electronic structures. So I went to the painful part of re-implementing the beautiful tight binding models that has been produced by Steven and by Xiang in order to see the electronic structure and see the effect of relaxation on the band structure. So this we can do only, of course, if the layers are actually in a periodic structure. And here we have this angle theta, which is approximately 1.08 degree, where there is a supercell, and we can compute the band structure. This is here with a little, so this is two layers of graphene with interlayer potential difference of 100 millielectron volts for a reason I will explain in a second. And then the band structure is like this. It gives you these flat bands. This is very close to the magic angle. There is a little splitting here that is due to this interlayer potential. And if I introduce relaxation into the picture, I recompute the band structure, and I see that actually I open up a gap, for example, that did not exist in the unrelaxed picture. So experimentally, this is very important because we know that there is a gap on both sides, on the hole and electron side. So if we don't include the relaxation for the purpose of computing the electronic structure, we will not see this important effect. All right, so now, what's interesting is that when we introduce this interlayer potential difference, it's known that the AB and BA structures have a gap. And so what happens in practice is that we will see the, so the structure has these triangular domains of AB and BA domains. And there we have a gap, which is here in red. And then between those, there is edge modes that will appear and form essentially a network of domain walls on which we have these edge modes that can give you interesting electronic signatures. So in order to plot this, I actually used this kind of novel object that I discovered a couple of months ago, and it's called the localizer. So this is very interesting. This is there's a series of papers by Terry Loring where he introduces this object. Essentially, we take the Hamiltonian H, which is the tight binding Hamiltonian. And then we put it in this bigger object of twice the size. We have H minus some given energy, and then E minus H on the diagonal. And here we have the position operators X and Y. Kappa is a tuning parameter, essentially, allowing me. And then the eigenvectors, or the eigenvalues of this operator, which are close to zero, are objects that are close to being eigenvectors of the Hamiltonian for the energy E. And in addition, they are localized around x0 and y0. All right, so they are almost eigenvectors of all three operators at the same time, the Hamiltonian, the x operator, and the y operator. And therefore, when I scan x0 and y0 here, I can see locally whether there exists a localized state for the Hamiltonian, which is close to this particular energy. So here are the eigenvalues of the localizer scanning from left to right at y equal to 0, like this. And you what you can see is that in most places there is a gap. So we don't have a state which is at these, an eigenstate of the Hamiltonian, which is at these particular positions. And here we have a crossing around zero, meaning that there is actually like the edge mode. And this is actually linked strongly to topological insulators. So here we know that there is some kind of topology in these structures. So there is a crossing of the eigenvalues here, which is protected. Because we are not breaking time reversal symmetry, there is not really a preferred direction. There is two modes going in both directions, one going up, one going down in this plot. So these are not the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian, these are eigenvalues of the localizer, but essentially this is kind of the same idea. And then this allows me to plot this, just like in experiment you would do like TEM or something like this, looking at the local density of states in the sample. All right, so this is kind of my motivation now, but I'm going to move away from bilayers, because we kind of understand bilayers at least for the relaxation part. So I want to talk about trilayer systems. Something like this, where I have three layers. So here I'm ambitious, and I'm talking about molybdenum disulfide and then two layers of graphene. In practice, we've been looking more at things that are three times the same material, but it's really from a mathematical point of view the same thing, not from the computational one. But so as Mitch was mentioning, if we look from the top, there is not much structure to be seen. It looks very disordered. But actually, we can make sense of all of this through configuration space. So we have the lattices Rj, the basis vectors Ejs and gamma Js is the unit cell. And in general, you could write some kind of atomistic model that would be the most general I can imagine. I just have many body effective potentials here, Vjs, that take into account all the different positions of an infinite set of atoms, which would be distributed. And I would look maybe for the ground state of this. So what does it mean? It's not really clear because this is not necessarily a finite quantity. But effectively, this is kind of an infinite-sized optimization problem. Because there is no periodicity, and we come back to this repeatedly, we cannot really deal with this problem directly. But nevertheless, this is kind of the guideline. This is what we would, in theory, like to solve. All right. Turns out this is not really well posed, as I was saying. But nevertheless, it gives us some idea. So the key point is that this is not a disordered system. It's still a very ordered system. Each layer is almost periodic, and this is what saves us.
So Paul, why do you call it optimization problem?
Well, minimizing this energy.
Minimizing. Okay, there's no right. Non-trivial constraint.
No.
Okay.
All right, so what saves us is the fact that we can actually label, essentially, every different configuration of the system. So in order to know where the atoms in layer, the bottom layer, which is here red, I would just need to know this one vector B1, and then by periodicity, before relaxation, I know where all the other atoms are. B2 gives me the second layer, B3 gives me the third layer, so the Bs are the disk registries. I have a group of horizontal translations, which is just translating my origin, which is pretty arbitrary here, it's just the point from which I'm looking, essentially. And then we have the uniform priority measure, which turns out to be the right one because essentially that we have this Birkhoff property, the ergodicity from mathematicians, which just means that by looking at the whole space, I'm uniformly sampling the space of configurations that I was just defining. So it's the same thing. The big difference is that on one side of this equation, I have to kind of take a thermodynamic limit, look at the entire space. On the other side, I'm integrating over a compact set. It's compact, which is really nice. It's high dimensional, which is not so nice, because here, omega, which is the set of configurations, B1, B2, B3 are each two-dimensional tori. So I take three of them, I combine it, I have a six-dimensional space. We can reduce it to four later, but it's still getting big. This is intrinsic in the problem. There is no saving grace from another way. We cannot really simplify this, but this is the nature of the problem. All right, so then my displacement fields, essentially the way I'm going to move my atoms, I assume that they can be parameterized by the original disk registry before the atoms are moved. I assume there is a smooth mapping from where the atom starts before relaxation to where it is going, and this smooth mapping is U, for example, for this purple atom. So looking from this purple atom, I have disk registry B1, B3 plus A2 over there. And my atom is going to move them from the mapping U2. So you see it actually, because if I'm looking from this atom over there, it's pretty clear that B2 is equal to zero. So that's how I save myself two dimensions. Now the configuration for this purple atom is just B1 and B3. So I have three maps, one for each layers. And they depend each on gamma 2, gamma 3 for the first one, gamma 1, gamma 3 for the second one, and so on. And then basically, this parameterization will allow me to parameterize relaxation, to parameterize the displacements of all my atoms just by knowing these three maps, which again are defined on a compact set, set which is relatively small. Instead of having to look at the whole space, I just have to look at this small four-dimensional torus. All right, and then formally, again, coming back to the many body potentials, I would rewrite what I had before as a kind of infinite sum for each atom. I look at the local configuration, I compute the potential because I know where all the atoms have moved depending on the maps U1, U2, and U3, and I get this infinite sum again. But because of my Birkhoff property, because of ergodicity, I can replace this infinite sum by just integrons over the configuration space. And this is what essentially is a compact formulation now, something that I can deal with. I don't have an infinite sum anymore. I just have integrons over compact sets. Okay, so now I just have to compute this and minimize this, and hopefully I will be in a good state. So now let's look a little bit closer at what drives essentially the relaxation. There are two main effects. One is intralayer kind of energy considerations, which is basically elasticity. Each layer is strongly bonded and doesn't like to be distorted too much. Its resting ground state is just this hexagonal lattice, and it doesn't like to be distorted from it. And the other consideration is that we have some interaction between the layers, which in particular, they prefer to be in this kind of staggered configuration here, the AB stacking, rather than something intermediate, like in the domain wall, or even worse, the AA stacking, which is really much higher energy compared to all the others. When I say much higher, it's still pretty clear that the intralayer contribution is dominant. The layers are strongly bonded with themselves, and it's pretty hard to move them. So this, the reason that the two really interact is because they are on very different length scales. We have these very large length scales where the interlayer contribution kind of accumulates through a long, large length scale. All right. So let's look first at this interlayer energy. So the easiest way to describe it, as far as I understand, is to look just at the generalized stacking fault energy, which is you take two aligned layers, which are almost similar to what we are looking. So locally, it gives me an idea of the energy of my layers when they are not aligned. So I look at this aligned system. I can compute with DFT or something like this the exact energy of the system and then map it to this registry for a pair of layers. And then for when I have tri-layers, essentially, these interactions between the layers will just add up. So for graphene, we see how the AA stacking, when they are aligned, is much higher than for AB and BA. And the same thing happens for tungsten diselenide, depending on how you choose the origin. So this the questions I direct to Zoe. And basically, this is an alternative which is easier compared to using atomic potentials that are also a possibility. In principle, this is an ab initio approach that is more accurate. And we can actually compute these things to, relatively simply, and they have an explicit simple functional form. So the total interlayer energy will be kind of a sum where I look at the interaction of the layer 1 with layer 2, and with layer 2 looking at layer 1, and then layer 2 looking at layer 3, and layer 3 looking down at layer 2. And I sum all of these contributions, this just to respect the symmetry between the two layers. So I see the interaction between layer 1 and layer 2 in blue, layer 2 and layer 3 in red. And I have this B that I will not explain further. It's a little bit complicated to explain, but it's really an easy, to really give you a precise definition, but it's a really easy meaning in the sense that this capital B is just a relaxed local misfit. So I have the original disk registry, I move layer 1, I move layer 3, and I get a new disk registry. So then to do this properly is actually a little bit technical, so I don't want to go through this, but that's the spirit of it. Okay, I just find out what is the new relaxed misfit as after moving both atoms on both sides, and then that gives me, for this original atom, essentially what is the new energy over there. Then I have the intralayer energy, which is an elastic contribution. Because the displacements are pretty small, it's pretty reasonable to look simply at linear elasticity in kind of a Cauchy-Born approximation. So here we have this kind of familiar expression. The one thing which is a little bit complicated is that uj is really defined on a four-dimensional configuration space. So what does it mean to take the gradient here? It's really a gradient of when I take my origin in my four-dimensional space, I'm moving it around. That gives me kind of a plane in this four-dimensional space, and I take the gradient on that two-dimensional subspace. So it looks like this. This is the formula here. This, if you're a bit familiar with the Moiré kind of soupesant, you can see how this would arise from the moiry between layer 1 and layer 2, and this is layer 1 and layer 3. And this gives me essentially the gradient of U1, and then I would have the gradient of U2, gradient of U3. And then Cj is an elasticity tensor, which is just obtained from DFT. So just a remark, because I will comment on this later, this is nice, but of course, if I look in Fourier space, because things are periodic as a function of these trajectories, so I can just take the Fourier components of the intralayer energy, and then this is kind of diagonalized, so this is nice. But we can also look at what the Fourier multipliers essentially look like, and given in reciprocal space for here, this is U1, so it's parameterized by B2 and B3. So in reciprocal space, I will get gamma k, which is in the reciprocal lattice of layer 2, and gamma gl, which is in the reciprocal lattice of layer 3. And here, they end up being summed with these matrices in front of them here. And the one thing which is dangerous here is that there is no guarantee that this is big. This, because GK and GL are incommensurate, this guy here could be very small even though GK and GL are very big. And that's not what you want in a normal elliptic equation. This would not happen. You would have a bound from below telling you that if you have big reciprocal lattice vectors, GK and GL, so fast oscillations, this should give you a high energy. And this is not the case here. It could give you a small energy because, yes, it oscillates very fast in this direction, but if you look in the transverse direction, which is a plane, so in four dimensions, it oscillates fast. In the two dimensions where we're looking at, it oscillates slowly because it's the moiré direction, if you want. Anyway, so when we bring all this together, we can write the potential energy, and then we can derive it to get the Euler-Lagrange equation, and we get something which is essentially a linear elasticity equation. Which you can solve essentially self-consistently. So this is not electronic structure, but it's the same idea. We have a nonlinear PDE, which is actually, I haven't seen really something looking like this before, so it was kind of interesting just from that point of view. So you have the phi is the GSFE, the general stacking fault energy. We have this kind of complicated expression here, giving me the function f theta that appears here and there. Important thing, it's this kind of periodic as a function of x, and I get these two coupled equations. I can use a fixed point argument, show that at least for small perturbations, there exists a solution here. So this is for a bilayer. Okay, and why this works for a bilayer is we've been hearing this a lot today, because this is a continuum problem. And for a bilayer, the moiré cell is now a periodic cell. So for the bilayer, it turns out that you cannot escape the periodic case as soon as you move to a kind of continuum description. And therefore, everything is fine. What I was telling you before, that there is a problem of ellipticity, that there is a problem that you get these big Gs and small energy contributions, does not happen. And then, all right, so we can get some numerical results. So I will kind of go not too slowly through this, but so the first thing to check is whether this behaves kind of in a realistic, reasonable manner. So we have these four-dimensional grids, uniform. We use the FFT to compute the elastic energy, some LBFGS algorithm. It's actually kind of expensive already, so I just want to point this out. Even if you want just 100 points in each direction, in four dimensions, this is now a really high-dimensional optimization problem. So kind of expensive, but it works in our experience at least. So for this pair of angles here, so we have a larger angle between layer 1 and layer 2, and layer 2 and layer 3 over here have a smaller angle, so the relaxation is sharper, essentially for the smaller angle compared to the bigger one. And because this is a four-dimensional space, you must see that I'm not plotting you the full four-dimensional picture here. So what we've done to get this is I've looked at layer 1 and layer 2, the kind of energy as a function of the original this registry, by averaging the position of layer 3. Okay, so that I get a reasonable thing. And here I average over the position of layer 1, looking at the collision, the coupling between layer 2 and layer 3. And this gives me this displacement over here and the effective GSFE after relaxation, where we see that the AA domains have shrunk, the AB and BA domains are now big and triangular, and this is what we expect. So the averaging with respect to the other layer makes the apericity disappear. So to make that come back, I'm going to now look in real space, kind of expand from my configuration space, parameterize kind of a flake, a finite sample, and see where it's moved and what we can see about the pattern. So now we have kind of a real space cut of the moiré, of, well, not moiré, but of these three layers together. And what you see, this is layer one and layer two and layer three, and you know, this is a tiny little box over here where you see already plenty of atoms, and they move according to the moiré over here. And then we have this additional length scale that appears here, and this is the moiré of moiré, the interaction between the two, the moiré between layer 1 and layer 2, and then layer 2 and layer 3. And if you look in this picture, which is the GSFE again, it's a little bit more apparent. So this here would be the atomic scale. All three of them. Yes. I should have mentioned that. So this is three layers of graphene, and we have here layer one, right? So this is the atomic scale here in this tiny little box that we cannot even see at the bottom of the black losange. All right. So that's the moiré scale. And if you zoom out here, that's kind of something happening at the moiré scale, and here we see a faint something appearing at a much larger length scale. So those are coming from these higher resonances, so the moiré of moiré. But even here we see that the moiré scale is not periodic. There's been something happening, and here we have something which should be a AAA node, basically, as this one, if we were to continue, but actually it has moved and avoided being a AAA point. There is no AAA stacking. The A and A of layer 1 and 2 and A and A of layer 2 and 3 have moved further apart, so they avoided each other because that would be really bad energetically. And the strongest effect you can see in the middle, because layer 2 really interacts with layer 1 and layer 3, so this one we really see a lot of relaxation, a lot of more interesting patterns. All right, so just to conclude basically, about this, so what's happening is that precisely we are seeing these long-range resonance modes. I call them really resonances because this is how I understand them. That happened because of this. So these coefficients here, you can expand them like this. So this belongs to layer 1, layer 3, layer 1, and layer 3. This object ends up being a member of the reciprocal lattice of layer 2. So I'm adding three reciprocal lattice vectors, one in layer 2, one in layer 1, and one in layer 3. That's my coefficient here that will enter into this expression over there. And if I wanted to control this from below, I'm out of luck because my lattices are incommensurate, and therefore this sum here can be as small as I want, even though the g's are large vectors. And therefore, from a mathematical point of view, this is really hard. So what we call hypoellipticity. You have essentially resonant length scale that are larger and larger and larger, and you lose the nice properties of knowing that there is a minimum, essentially, because where do you stop? You have to stop somewhere. So of course, this is kind of artificial, right? From a physics point of view, we know that the system is not perfect. There is some noise, some motion, and things like this. So this is really a mathematical question here that I'm posing, but it's a very difficult and interesting one. So just to conclude, here is the moving out from length scale to length scale. So this is at the level of unit scale. Unit sounds, you have three layers that are hexagonal. So this is A and this is B. And you move out at the level of the moiré pattern, and you see just simple triangular patterns that appear, essentially. Now, you move out again, and you see that these are not as regular as you thought initially. So this is especially for layer 2. You see how this is not similar to this and not similar to this. So there is not the strong periodicity that we could have in a bilayer system. And actually, we can still move out and still see that there is, you know, inhomogeneities, that things are not settling down. So this mathematical issue that I was pointing out is actually a real issue, at least in this case. Of course, now it's an open question, I guess, for the experimentalists, whether such scale of system can be realized to such a precision, right? I mean, that there are obviously other factors that will introduce disorders into these kind of structures. All right. So this is my conclusion now. For the mathematicians in the room, I guess, there is a big problem of well-posedness. It's what we call the small divisor problem, where you have resonances at many length scales and loss of regularity of the solution, and it's not clear whether there are solutions that are smooth in configuration space. And this is a well-known thing, in fact, for the Frankel contour of Amarnon, that you have non-smooth solutions in configuration space. That means that the well-known transition from a regime where you can smoothly essentially move, this is a one-dimensional model, you can move one chain, for example, in a potential. But if the potential becomes too big, then the atoms become stuck. This is what it means. From an electronic structure point of view, I would like to move forward now to make new models, essentially including these relaxation effects, especially for trilayers. The difficulty is that now the supercells are really, really, really big. So even the tight binding models are too expensive. But it would be interesting to see if we can look at these edge states that exist in the bilayer example, and maybe they also give you some interesting patterns in the trilayer examples for the same reasons. And finally, maybe we can also move outside of the 2D materials. These kind of patterns of interacting lattices can definitely be created outside, say, using metamaterials and so on. So if the properties are interesting, this is something to look at. And finally, there is a link with the quasicrystals that I don't quite understand yet. It's very similar in the sense that there is a higher dimensional space behind the scenes that is giving you the kind of intuition and description, but it's also not like a quasicrystal, which has a lot of properties that we do not see in these examples as far as I know. So something to see in the future, I guess. And thank you for your attention.